Well, by cracky, I guess I gotta talk with an accent if I'm gonna be accepted here, eh? You're not gonna get it. Nope. Sorry. Okay.
I don't think we can.
She'll
do
hit
that.
Me if I try that one. All right. But I gotta lighten you up a little bit. It's late in the afternoon. You're tired, and so we're going to try to keep this a little bit light, and we're trying not to feedback on one another. All right.
Guess... Really? I have to stand way over here.
No. Can we get it so we're not? All right. I think we'll be fine. But whenever Heather and I talk, the most important thing we do is turn to the Lord to guide us and use us. And we want to do that now. If we can start with a word of prayer, please. Lord, we thank you for this privilege to speak on this important matter this day. Your word, your truth, the truth that sets us free from all the lies of this world and gives us hope, confidence, and joy. Use our words this day and all of our meditations on your word that it might glorify you and be a witness to this world of a truth they so desperately need. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I know in listening to Dr. Manoj and the other speakers as well, I just sit there and Heather keeps holding me back as I want to jump up and say, yeah, but there's hope. Don't give up. Don't give up. Because you can get that, just the twist in your stomach that says, this is just so frustrating because it's such a lie. The deceiver, Satan, just wants to destroy relationships. He wants to destroy mankind. But God has a better plan, and that plan is revealed to us very clearly in the Word of God. I really appreciate what Professor Pless said earlier today. He was commenting from Oswald Bayer about this Lutheran ethic, that it's not so much about what we do, but about what we have been given. And that's what we're going to focus on now. It's not who we are that matters, it's whose we are. And so if we can go ahead and move into this topic, whose am I? And I am not my own. I do not make myself. As we heard before, we all have belly buttons that speak against that idea. We are made by a mighty creator. We are not self-autonomous. But that is good news. We are made by a loving creator who gave us life and has given us new life in his son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. And the greatest news of all is that he loves us so much that he claims us as his bride, the bride of Christ. And it is that picture of Jesus as the great bridegroom and us as his bride that changes everything else and gives us hope for our relationships and why we're here and where we're going. This message that Heather and I have shared all over the North America, Central America, South America, it has been a message that has touched lives wherever we've gone. And it really has brought about the same effect. Doesn't matter culture, doesn't matter language, doesn't matter economic level. God's word brings hope to everyone, and the truth of his word can apply to everyone in any situation. I found that in a lot of places where I've had the privilege to go and speak on these topics, and just gonna give you a quick slide presentation here, picture presentation of some of those places, and kind of note the pictures of the faces that you'll see in these quick images. Some of them, especially these first couple, are not very good because they go back in history. So if we can go ahead here, and this is me when I had hair back
That's when I first met you.
Just a few months after we met. Yeah. This was back in 1992 when I went on a short-term mission trip to Malawi, Africa. Back then, talking about relationship with Jesus, that he's the most important thing. These guys were a little scared. They're not as smiley. My translator there, he was pretty excited. The next one, go on. The other direction, yeah. All right. This is another group of the guys we trained there in Africa. We're really excited about it. I'm going to move through these pretty quickly, so if we can go on to our next. And this girl, she embodied what we were about. And just the delight of the children there was so exciting. And just keep going. This is in Guatemala when we did our marriage seminar specifically. Heather and I did that one back about 8 years ago, 9 years ago. We first went there, and was received with great joy by the couples there. It translated well into their language, and they loved it. Next one, please. There's another group the next year in Guatemala, a larger group that we presented to, going on, and it led to couples praying together. Also, the youth that we worked with, they were turned on by this truth of God's word and excited to hear it. In Paraguay, South America, we had a huge assembly, and even competing with the barbecue smoke floating through the hall the whole time, we still were able to get through in a way that the people were pretty excited about and thrilled to hear. And in Panama, we had couples that could hear us in English, a lot of them, and yet they had a different cultural background, and still, they were thrilled by that message. And the youth in Panama as well. And also moving on then to a naval school in Panama, where the students there were excited about this message. And another youth assembly in Panama, the thumbs up they're doing, I'm going to talk about that more in just a moment. That's a key part of what we're going to talk about here.
Other way.
And then in, this is in Peru, when we were there just 2 years ago. And you'll note our cool hats were down in the lower front. And then this is in northern Wisconsin with a group of pastors at a Grace Place event that we did. In all of these contexts, every single person we talked to, they could resonate to the message, not because we are so wonderful, but because God is so awesome. And he has a message that does go to everybody. And what is that message? It's a message of whose we are. So if we can look on to this, then a key passage that I like to focus on more than any other is this one from Ephesians 5, verse 31. And that Ephesians 5 passage actually goes back to a quote from Genesis 2:24, and also then from Jesus in Matthew 19:5. It is the key passage on marriage that you've heard many times, and that passage goes back to when God made man and woman, and he said, a man will leave his mother and father, hold fast to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. God the Father said those words at creation when he made man and woman perfect in his image. When Jesus was here on earth, even though man had become corrupt, he said, marriage is still to be that way. He says, divorce isn't in my plan. It is to be one man, one woman, leave mother and father, hold fast to wife, become one flesh. And then when St. Paul, under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, was speaking in the early days of the Christian church, he said the same thing. That thing about marriage, still true today. Those three concepts. So to unpack that passage, you have to get the three key points that are in that passage that come from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit at three points in history: creation, recreation, and inspiration by the Spirit in the early days of the church at the time of Pentecost. That same message is this: a man will leave his mother and father, hold fast to his wife, the two become one flesh. And if you unpack what those concepts are all about, leaving mother and father, it's a matter of sacrifice. To have a relationship with someone, you've got to sacrifice your own self-will, your own self-autonomy, your autonomous belief that I can master my own identity. Sacrifice such foolish concepts. And then to choose to leave behind your own self and choose to focus on another. An unconditional commitment to another person, a choice. And to become one flesh, that brings in the physical part of the relationship. I'm going to have you involved with me here to keep you awake this afternoon. So hold up your left hand, if you would, and make an L in front of you, all right? L for leave. You got to leave your selfishness. And then fold it a little bit to make a C, choose. Choose to care for another, to care for that person unconditionally. With your right hand, hold up a 1, number 1, and become one in flesh, to care physically about the other person. And now you just take those and blend them together, and you get a triangle. Make it into a triangle with the point on top, like the triangle you see up here. That's the kind of relationship God intends for a husband and wife to have. And we learn of that relationship from the perfect husband, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ left his place in the security of heaven, left that secure place to come to earth to be among us. And he chose to love us unconditionally, even to the point of death on the cross. And he chose to become one in flesh with us and dying in the flesh for us. And now he gives himself to us in the flesh in our very special sacramental theology as Lutherans that we should hold on to very strongly. It really grasps that special physical connection we have with our Lord Jesus Christ, that he gives us himself bodily for the forgiveness of our sin. That union of leaving, cleaving one flesh is what we're trying to get at now in what we look at in our own marriages, and it's an element of that in every relationship. If you want to have a good relationship, you got to have aspects of that. I'm going to use Heather as my whiteboard here since I don't have one. So Heather, hold up a triangle for me. All right, okay. There we go. So we got a triangle of marriage, and say that this lower left angle is your entrance angle to a relationship. You choose to get to know someone. And as you get to know that person, if you're really going to connect, you have to start moving along the other sides of the triangle. One, you got to leave your comfort zone, start moving up the top side of that triangle. You also have to come into the physical proximity of the other person. And so starting to move across the bottom side of that triangle too. And so you've got a triangle that you start from the very beginning and in relationship with it being equilateral. That goes back to my math background. It should be equilateral, equal sides, so it's strong. Too many relationships today start into it. They say, hey, I like that cute girl over there. Let's jump in bed together. And you jump from here to here, and instead of building the top, you have a flat line. And that's what that relationship is. It's a flat line. It's dead. Doesn't work. Falls flat. And any other relationship where you don't keep that triangle strong, it's going to teeter one way or the other. You got to work on building that relationship. And it builds up to the pinnacle of the top, the leave. That's the pinnacle is the wedding day when you commit before God and other witnesses, I'm going to do this for the rest of my life until death do us part. And it's when you're at that top point that then the triangle reaches the lower right angle, the physical union of one man to one woman. And in that context, you have a strong triangle that can last and endure. Jesus shows us such love. Of course, he does not have that physical union with us in sexuality, but he has a much superior union in giving himself to us in the flesh and uniting with us in a way that we will be with him physically for eternity, raising our bodies from the dead to be with him forever. So that special triangle is what we're trying to build here. And I bring that up because this then is the way we show Jesus to the world. It makes evident a mystery that is unfathomable to man. As I move on here, I want to look at this. I share that little video clip from our trip to Guatemala when I was preaching there because it showed in that triangle that you saw on that one, the cross in the middle. That's the key. Because in Christ, we learn how to build these kind of relationships. And that marriage relationship is about pointing people to the cross. And in Guatemala, they grasp that concept to make visible this gospel that is for all people. And it really is a gospel for everyone, for the single, for the divorced, for the married person, for the homosexual person, it's the same gospel for all because we belong to Christ. That's our focal point. And so this good news for everyone is that we are married to Christ and that he is united to us. And in this marriage relationship then, we have a mystery. In Ephesians 5:32, St. Paul says this union of cleave, become one flesh, it is a profound mystery. But I'm talking about Christ and his bride, the church. The mystery about it is not that it's unknown to us. It's that it's so wonderful, it goes up against what we think of usually. How can someone love us that much? How can God love us that much? That he gave himself for us. How can God love us so much that Jesus, the Son of God, died for us? And that mystery then too, how can a husband and wife love each other that much? Where they're willing to sacrifice their own selfishness and to choose to care for one another. It is possible when we learn it from Jesus. This mystery can become visible, incarnate, when we learn from him how to sacrifice and to love as he first loved us. So in a perfect marriage, we are to be showing justification to the world, the way we are right with God. It's about humbling yourself. It's not about you. And giving freely the love that you first received from Jesus. We show that gift from Jesus as we relate to one another. The idea of showing that picture of love to the world that shows Jesus and our how we're saved by him, Heather and I try to model that all the time. And for her, it's a matter of submitting to me, not because I'm such an awesome, wonderful guy, even though that's all.
Well, you are pretty good.
Now, it's insofar, it really is an insofar of subscription to me as the head of the family. She follows my lead insofar as I'm following the lead of Christ. I am to be Christ to her in the family, to love her sacrificially, unconditionally, as Jesus does. And she submits to that because I am acting as Christ to her. And in that way, then we are showing that same picture to the world. That's the way we as Christians submit to Jesus, because we know he would only do what is good for us. I know Heather has some thoughts on that concept of submission a little
bit,
too.
This has been such a concept to me that it has been hard for me to speak about because of the concept of submission. Oh, it's a word that should not be used in society. Well, I came up with my own acronym for it, the way I think about submission, because, you know, ultimately, when we're submitting to our husbands, it really begins with submitting to Christ. And if I'm not willing to submit to God, then how am I going to submit to my own husband? So my acronym is, kind of follow this with me, S would be saying ultimately that both my heart and my will must be in line with the will of Christ. So first I need to submit to Christ, because then together, as Ephesians 5:21 says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And so that's how I think about this term for submission. And I also had heard it said one time that the man is the head of the house, but the wife is the neck, right? So, you know, there's a lot of leeway. You can't have the head without the neck. You can't have the neck without the head. And so, you know, I have a lot of my own opinions and my own thoughts, but together as a unit, we are moving in the same direction.
And so when we're together like that, so Heather, she submits to me when I'm acting as Christ, it shows that love of Christ that I'm giving for her. And she submits to me because I'm loving her as Christ loves us. The world says, I can't submit to him, I can't trust him. It's where forgiveness comes into play. You gotta have forgiveness with one another. And teaching that forgiveness to the world is so essential. I'm gonna come back to that a little bit more in just a moment, but marriage relationships must be marked by this mutual submission to each other. It really is a mutual submission. I submit to her in that I'm going to love her the way Christ loved me. I'm going to put her will above my own. Even though I'm the head making decisions for us together, I'm submitting to her will because I want her to be joyful in life. I can't make her happy all the time, but I want to point her to the joy of the Lord. And so I seek to do that, and all things keep our eyes focused on Jesus. Want to move into my next point here, and marriage shapes all of our relationships. If you have marriage right, that triangle where it is about sacrifice and unconditional commitment and having that physical care for one another, if you get that right in a marriage, you can apply that to all your other relationships as well. We have this, I like to use what I call a thumbs up illustration. And so I've got this next image that kind of shows this hand with the thumb up to Jesus. And you can do this with me now if you want to, hold out your hand, but thumbs up, all right? So thumbs up, Jesus on top. He's got to be number one in our lives. Our identity comes from him. It's not something we make up. Whose are we? We're his. Through baptism. That makes us someone of value. So thumbs up to Christ, who gives me forgiveness of my sin, all of my failures. So thumbs up to him. And then you as the individual are the palm of the hand. Kind of the unimportant part when you look at a hand, you don't look at the palm right away. It's the fingers that get all the attention, and that's the way it really should be for us. We are the palm, but the love of Christ flows through that palm into the fingers that represent all your relationships in the world. And in those levels of relationships, the number one relationship is spouse. And this is not a gun pointing at my spouse. It's not what it's about. But it is number one relationship after Jesus. The first human relationship is my spouse. And I care for her above all others. That's why in the passage it says a man will leave his mother and father and hold fast to his wife. Mother and father aren't top. Neither are children. Because they're preparing to leave mother and father. So children, parents, all those who you're related to by biology or marriage, they come in the next finger down. And that's those people, you are committed to them. You're to care for them. That's why that passage talks about leaving mother and father. Mother and father are important. So they are the next finger down in your level of relationships, people you are to be caring for, and children and all those other family members. After that comes the household of faith. do good to all, but especially to the household of believers. So all your fellow believers in Christ who remind you to point your eyes back to Jesus and keep you on track with Jesus. So all those believers in Christ are down here. Now do this with me again, a little review. Thumbs up to who?
Jesus,
all right. Next is?
Spouse.
Next is?
Children, family.
And next is?
Church.
Now try to hold it right there. Keep your pinky on your palm. Don't let it move. Can you do that?
Some people
kind of hard to do, isn't it?
Angus
can. Your pinky just wants to come out. You have to work at it to get it to stay down there. If you work real hard, you might. But this illustrates that the pinky represents all the other relationships in life who you are to reach out to. When you get the top ones in order from the top down, your relationship with Jesus and all the other people up here, the fellow believers, then that love for the world is going to flow out of that. When you have it right, they're going to see your love in what you're doing up here, and you'll have an open hand of welcome to others saying, let me tell you about my Lord, my Jesus, and the way I show that love in my other relationships. And it's a love that's there for you too. This is a gift we can give to the world. It doesn't matter who they are. The person who's caught up in the lies of homosexuality or wherever they are, we can reach out to them with that open hand. If you close in your relationships and keep them to yourself, instead you got a fist to really say to the world, I don't care about you. I'm here to take care of myself. Get that hand open. Hand out that life that Christ has given to us with his kind of love, a sacrificial love that chooses to care for the other and not just take care of self, and that cares enough to go into the physical need of the other person and to be there and care for what they are, where they are. So that illustration of the thumbs up, it is a model for Christian marriage, to have that Christians model that godly marriage that is a witness to everyone else in the relationships below. One man, one woman marriage, it is a picture of justification, as I said, as you're showing his love and forgiving one another. It'll touch your children and all the other relationships in life. And it is to proclaim this love to all people. Why? To save people, to save their souls, to hand out life to them. We need to stand up for God's way for marriage, not just as a matter of so that we can keep marriage as a good thing. That's important. It's the foundation of society. But we stand up for marriage because it's a matter of the gospel. Marriage is that best picture in the world of the way Jesus loves us. When we live marriage in God's way, not in the world's way, not as Angus was saying, this new way of looking at it, whatever you define it to be, in God's way, it is a picture of the way Jesus loves us, where it's not about you, it's sacrifice and unconditional commitment, caring for the physical well-being of the other. If we hold up that kind of marriage, it is a way to hand out life to the world. We cannot give up godly marriage because we can't give up the gospel. We can't give up the only hope for the world. We've got to let it show. And that's why we stand up so strong for this life that is ours in Christ. It is a gospel message that brings hope to people everywhere. When we were in Paraguay doing our seminar, we talked about these concepts on a Saturday, and there were about 150 people there at this seminar. The next day, we gathered at a local church, and the pastor there was preaching, and in his message, he said, I put it aside. I have a new one today. And in the middle of his message, he started going like this and this, and even in Spanish, I was going, I know what he's talking about. I get it. And everyone out there was going like this, and they're shaking their heads. Yes, I understand. It makes sense to put Christ on top and let that flow down into all of our relationships. And then the triangle with Christ on top. And they were filled with this joy of knowing it's about freedom in Christ. He's the one who sets us free from the lies. And so then in that worship time, they all started singing. Got this little video clip here I want to show you from that worship that day when we were together. The zombie look of my kids sitting next to me is because we got about 3 hours of sleep the night before. And so anyway, They were really excited. They really were. They were on fire with the joy of the Lord. All right.
But that was neat to just be able to sing with them, and they were singing Spanish, and we were following along. It was a neat experience.
And so that joy of the Lord that sets people free wherever you go. But now I need to acknowledge the downer part of all of this. This concept of Jesus loving us with the perfect love of a perfect husband, and us trying to show that to the world, it is an unfathomable mystery to the blind. As we hear from this 1 Corinthians 2:14 passage, the world just can't grasp it at all.
The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned.
The concept of justification just doesn't make sense to natural reason, the way God teaches it. You're not justified by just thinking yourself good. If I say, I'm good by your self-autonomy, that doesn't make you any good. But it comes from Christ, and that's a hard thing for natural man. They don't want to give up on themselves. We don't want to give up on our own power. And so we fight against that. And having our identity in Jesus, no, my identity is whatever I make it to be. I want to be my own self-identifier. But to humble yourself and say, Jesus is the one who defines who I am, that's tough. One man, one woman marriage? That doesn't make sense either. Because I want to do it whatever way I want to do. And I don't want to submit to a husband, the wife may say. And the husband may say, I don't want to sacrifice for her. I want to do it my own way. And we fight against it all the time. This concept of understanding the mystery is only possible through the work of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit that comes through us through holy baptism, through the Word of God. It is that Spirit that will help us to see God's better way. So what I'm getting at here is, we who are sitting here, we shouldn't just sit here and curse the darkness. And now I sit here and I hear some of those things that Angus was telling us before about how the world has redefined things, and it just makes me start to bubble up inside and get angry, and how can they be so deceived? And I just hate that kind of, we got to stand up and fight against that, and we got to knock some sense into their heads. But they're not the enemy. Those people that you're hitting upside the head, you're not getting to the real problem. It's what's in their heart. It's whose they are right now. They're not their own. They're under the control of Satan and his power. They've let themselves be taken over by the father of lies. And that's where the real enemy is, that father of lies. And so we speak a truth that the Spirit can reveal to them by the Spirit's power. Their hearts can be changed. It can pull them around to the truth that can set them free from that deception of Satan. Don't try to argue people into believing. Don't go out and give all the statistics and quote from what you've heard earlier today and say, you've got to believe it. See, here's the facts. You know, it didn't persuade those five justices on the Supreme Court. They went with feeling. Didn't matter how many facts were presented in front of them. Same thing with your neighbor. Those who are deceived by Satan will continue to be deceived. Our strength, though, that is the greatest strength of all, is the gospel of Christ Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we must submit ourselves to the bridegroom and let him be in control, even of this witnessing to the world. As we are reminded in Romans 3:23,
for all have sinned and fall. Fall short of the glory of God.
That falling short is ongoing present on there in the Greek for that passage. Sorry, Heather.
That's okay.
I didn't tell you that was
totally
there.
Totally caught off guard.
Just kind of ongoing.
This is why I'm up here, for the humor factor of it. Oh, and I'm the token woman. See? Thank you very much. I'm honored.
And she keeps me in line when I get off track. She gives me this nudge.
Yeah, come on. Right. I try to do it.
Or like when we're in South America and I try to tell a joke and she says,
it's not going over,
it's
honey.
It's not flying. Give it
come
up.
On, keep going.
Acronyms don't work in translation. Anyway, that ongoing present, we all have sinned and keep on falling. Even you and I sitting here, even if we know the truth, we continue to fall down and come short of the glory of God. We do make fools of ourselves. we do turn our back on Jesus, our great bridegroom, and we get ourselves into trouble again and again. So every one of us must turn back to the Lord Jesus for his help on a daily basis, because our failure is inevitable. His forgiveness and love will endure, however. That's why we keep him on top. The thumbs up to Christ isn't just a convenient thing because it's cool. Thumbs up to him, cool. But it's an essential thing. I need his forgiveness every day for when I fail. That's the only way our marriage can survive and thrive, because daily we fall short. But we turn to him, and his forgiveness and love endure for us. His sacrificial, unconditional, and incarnate love, in the flesh love, is there for us, and it does endure and will take care of us in our greatest need. And his forgiveness and love will flow into all of our relationships then. When Heather and I are working at it together to keep our love right, it flows down to our children and everyone else around us. Our children learned from early on in our relationship that number one is right here. And they didn't resent that. Instead, it gave them security. So many young moms I talk to today say, well, my kids are the center of my life. My husband's never around. I didn't say how much time you're spending. It's where your heart is and what you communicate to those children. To make those children have a secure environment where they know mom and dad will be there for me for the long haul, be strong up here. First of all, up here, then here, and then you'll give them that security they need for their own life. And you'll prepare them to be witnesses to the world, because mother and father are preparing those children to leave mother and father so they can go out and be a witness to the world on their own. So you model that love of Christ, the triangle at the top, and you give them the foundation for a triangle. And you tell them, don't go out and cohabit before you're married or have sex before you're married because it's bad. No, that's not going to go very far. But if you tell them, don't do it because your triangle is going to fall flat and you're going to cheat yourselves of the ultimate triangle where it reaches its pinnacle and it's blessed by Jesus and it's awesome. And they can grasp that concept. I teach that in the pre-marriage work that I do all the time and in marriage counseling all the time. Going back to the triangle and the thumbs up has helped me in every counseling situation I've ever done. Every time I have a couple or even an individual, they come in and they talk about, I'm having this or that issue, I can see right away where this is out of order and this is out of order, where those elements are missing, the sacrifice, the unconditional commitment, the choosing to follow God's way and to care for the physical well-being of others. These things guide all of those relationships, and so you get them right, it flows down from the top to the bottom. So the thumb directs everything we do, gives us our identity, and it gives us the way we interact with all these people around us, with love and forgiveness. Going back then to the triangle, remember what I had on my triangle there when I was in Guatemala? What was in the center? A cross. We have to go to the cross on which Jesus died to make payment for our failures. We need it so we can give it. Heather and I go back to that cross on a daily basis. And that's something that has helped us to have a strong marriage all along the way. At the ending of each day, we reflect on the day and we have prayer time together, which is so important to us, physically present with each other, holding hands together at the end of the day, and talk it over with God, what's been going on that day. But before we even start the prayer, one of the first things we do is, what do I need to confess to you today? And I usually know by myself already, I know what I need to confess. And I start to share with her what I know has gone wrong. And I ask her for forgiveness. I don't just say, sorry I did that to you today. Sorry I complained about the food in front of the kids and said it was awful and I would rather go out to eat. That shouldn't have been done. Please forgive me.
I'm sorry the fish was really bad. But
we won't talk about the tuna the other night, right, Hannah?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, okay. You seek forgiveness rather than just saying, I'm sorry. That's how the love of Christ works. I go to Heather and I choose to make myself vulnerable. I sacrifice my selfish security. I say, I was wrong. Forgive me. I leave myself open. She can say, yeah, you should be sad. You should be feeling awful. You were wrong. But then she also sacrifices, and instead of trying to get vindictive and make me suffer, because she knows Jesus will get me if I don't fess up to him, instead she gets to
Ask for forgiveness also.
And give me forgiveness first.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, don't. Yeah, I know. We're both quick to jump to that, but to give me forgiveness and also confess to me. We want to give you a prime example. We found that stories often communicate better than my lecture, and that's why she goes into these seminars with me, because I get too preachy, and she makes it more real. We're going to give you an example of this. One of the great examples of how our relationship was a witness to a lot of people outside of the seminar. When we went to Peru 2 years ago, we led a couple of marriage seminars. They went great. We had great response. People just ate up this material from God's Word. But an instance that happened at the end of that tour puts this into real life in a way that really makes sense, and I think you'll understand.
So we were out getting souvenirs at the end of the trip. And I thought to myself, I really don't know, what am I going to take away from Peru that just really speaks of Peru to me? Couldn't really find anything. We were walking through the marketplace, and all of a sudden I heard some music playing. And we had been singing with them, and so I thought, well, that's probably a good idea. Let's try music, something musical. So we got to this vendor who was standing there, and he was holding this little instrument that I thought, oh, that's really cute. Kind of looks like a ukulele. In my mind, I'm thinking to myself, I had always wanted a ukulele.
I had no clue.
What? Apparently, I never communicated that with him, but I'm thinking, my niece has one, my nephew has one. So I thought, well, why don't I think about this, right? So I look at it and it just looked different. It didn't really look like the normal ukulele. So I said, hey, Todd, why don't you, I'm really bad at the bargaining part of it all. So I said, hey, why don't you go ask him how much that is? Well, the guy, of course, had a price. For you, we'll give you two, you four, whatever. I don't even remember what it was.
Special deal for you.
Special deal for you. I thought, I have no idea how much a ukulele is. I had nothing in my mind. So practically I'm thinking, nope, we're not even gonna go there. This was probably just a whim, you know, we don't even have that much money. But so we start walking away. Well, have you ever been in a foreign country trying to walk away from somebody? Nah, that doesn't work. He was following us the entire time. Several times we said, no, we're not interested. No, we're not interested. We got back to the room and I Googled, because I noticed it would look different, so I said Peruvian instruments, and a charango came up. See the name of it up there? Oh,
there's a charango.
That's what a charango looks like. Okay, so I thought, okay, well, it's Peruvian. It has 10 strings. It's kind of like a, how much do they cost? You know, Google is great, right? So I said to Todd, hey, you know, I am kind of interested in this, and so should we maybe consider this? And earlier, when the guy was pestering us, he said, only today. I will go over the mountain tomorrow. I will not be here tomorrow. I thought, over the mountain, right, you're gonna be here, right? So when we got back then and we were talking through it, I said, if we see that charango guy tomorrow, can we get it?
And I, as a loving husband who sacrifices my own practicality, said, I will get you a charango, even though I have no idea how we'll get it on the plane or get it home or how much we should really pay. But if we see that charango man tomorrow, I'll get it for you.
I said, thank you, God. And all night, all I could dream about was a charango. Remind you, 24 hours early, I didn't even know what a charango was, but all that was going through my mind was charango, charango, we get a charango tomorrow, right? So we wake up the next morning, we go into town, and I'm very calmly, come on, a little bit faster, I'm not hearing it, where's the guy? There was no charango man. I was devastated. I'm like, I had my heart set on this stinking charango, and now we're not even gonna get it. So we had, 10 minutes to get back to the hotel? And Mr. Practicality here is like, I'm sorry, honey, we haven't seen the charango man, and we're heading back to the hotel. I was devastated. Seriously, I want a charango. All of a sudden, I heard a charango. We honed in on it. We went to find the charango man. This is taking way too long. I'm sorry. Okay, speed it up. All right. So we found a charango man, and he
was a different charango man.
It was
not the charango man.
My mind's going, it's a triangle.
Who had a new price that was way up here, and I hadn't had no bargaining with him yet. So the previous bargaining from yesterday didn't matter now. I had to start at the top again.
I'm thinking it's a triangle. Let's get the triangle. Come on, we have 10 minutes. Let's go.
Well, it didn't work so well.
No.
I tried to bargain, and I didn't have time, and it was a different triangle man, and I had made a deal with God in my heart. If I see that triangle man, then that'll be my cue. I'm supposed to get that triangle. It wasn't the same one. I kind of said, okay, God, I guess you don't want us to get this triangle because it's not the same guy. That's my very logical reasoning, right?
And guess what?
But not smart reasoning.
We walked away. We got all the way back to the hotel, and I was almost in tears. I'm thinking, I don't have a triangle, and there was one back there. Oh,
so I wasn't on her good list, okay? Put it that way. And it was a very cold ride to the airport, even though it was a nice sunny day. And it was a very cold time sitting in the airport for 3 hours waiting for our flight. It was a very cold flight from Cusco down to Lima. And then it was
we
very cold,
much
12 hours
time.
Sitting in the airport in Lima. But during the time in Lima, we had a delay, so it was an extra time. There was a couple guys who are our hosts when we were there in Peru who said, we will meet you at the airport when you are in your layover there. We'll come see you. We said, yeah, right, that's not going to happen. No way they'll find us anyway. But they'd said they would, and so we thought, yeah, we'll see what happens. Well, while we were waiting for these guys, we weren't seeing them, but while we were waiting there during that 12 hours of time, the Lord started to work on us. The Spirit started to do its thing. It started to soften me. Instead of being angry at her for pouting and being like a baby and complaining.
Seriously, I was. I admit it. Because
I didn't come up with that. No. I'm just quoting what I heard, okay?
He was softening my heart too, thinking, yes, I'm pouting. I am being a real brat about this stupid triangle. So
I, as the head of the household, said, I got to step up here. I got to be a man, the head, the way Christ would. I humbled myself. Sacrificed my pride, my control. And I said, Heather, please forgive me for not just honoring you, even if it wasn't practical. I realize how special that was to you, and I am so sorry that I didn't get that for you. Please forgive me.
And I said, in the name of Christ, I forgive you, Todd. And please forgive me for pouting and not respecting you as the head of the household.
And in the name of Jesus, I forgive you, Heather. And it washed away so much hurt, so much anger. And we felt so much better right away that it was just a triangle. And I felt terrible, though, still, because I knew how much it meant to her. But she passed it off on me. Now she was free and happy. Okay, it's all done. And now I'm still going, oh,
I moved on.
Man.
Like, whatever.
And that's the burden of being in the image of Christ. Because long after our sins are gone to the cross, he still bears those sins for us. So I, as the husband, am still thinking, what can I do to make this better for Heather? I know she forgives me, but I sure wish I could bring joy to her at this time. I know it's an optional thing. God doesn't have to do it, but God, there's some way.
So can I tell the rest of the story?
Sure, in 1 minute.
Okay, 1 minute. So the Daniels ended up showing up.
Was there any Daniel and Daniel?
Oh, there were two Daniels, sorry. And they showed up at the airport, and I was lamenting to them this whole story, right? It wasn't quite as dramatic, but they understood. And the Daniel stood up, and he said, I have a friend who makes charangos. How much do you want to leave, and I'll have him mail it to you? After all that, I am getting a charango.
And I pulled the cash, and here you go, you know? And so I gave it to him, and...
What?
3 months later,
in the mail,
just in time for her birthday in October.
It was great, and it looks just like the picture, doesn't it? Yeah, I was like, it's so exciting.
And so we got our triangle. And it was just another way for God to say, you do it my way, and things you don't even deserve, as a gracious gift, I will give you more and more. We didn't deserve a triangle, and that wasn't our goal. And when we confessed to one another, it wasn't, so now God's got to get us a triangle. That wasn't it. Can't play that game with God. But you'll be amazed what God will do when you let him do his miraculous stuff. His mystery is hard to fathom, but it's so awesome and so wonderful. when you get to see it take place. And this story has now touched a lot more people than my little triangles ever have, because they hear that and say, I can relate to that, because I was right there and I didn't want to forgive my wife, and she was right there and she didn't want to forgive me. But by the power of the gospel, we can do wonderful things. So in closing, let me just say, this last slide I want to bring up here. The church will endure. It's not about you and me. The church on earth is under the power of the gospel, and it will endure no matter what this country falls into, no matter what anyone tries to say about their own identity and their own desire for what the church should be and where it should go into its little box in the corner. It's going to endure. Nothing, no power of Satan can overcome it. Absolutely guaranteed. And our identity and purpose will endure. We are baptized into Christ. We are made new in Him. And now our purpose and why we are here is to make this known to the world, because people are caught in the line. They need to hear the truth that will set them free. That's why we are here, to live marriage in His way in all of our relationships, bring elements of that marriage relationship into all of those in His way. And it will lead to real joy in this world as we are able to hand out His gift of life with Christ on top and all of our other relationships flowing with His love and His way, with His sacrifice, His unconditional commitment, and His care in the flesh for one another. Christ Jesus will work through us and will bless this world and will bring many to the joy of His salvation. That's why marriage has to be held up in His way. And we want to close before Dave runs us off the stage with a final blessing to you. Heather has been using this now, the triangle, for her MOPS. She's a mentor mom in MOPS group. They sing songs each week in MOPS, and she always ends with a blessing. And we want to leave you with the blessing from the Lord with the triangle, which is an instrument of the joy that we have in our Lord.
So this is an echo blessing. I will sing the first line, and you repeat it, please. May the Lord bless and keep you.
May the Lord bless and keep you.
May His face shine upon you.
May His face shine upon you.
May His blessings go with you.
May His blessings go with you.
And give you peace.
And give you peace.
May the Lord bless and keep you.
May the Lord bless and keep you.
May His face shine upon you.
May His face shine upon you.
May His blessings go with you.
May His blessings go with you.
And give you peace.
And give you peace.
One more time. May the Lord bless and keep you.
May the Lord bless and keep you.
May His face shine upon you.
May His face shine upon you.
May His blessings go with you.
May His blessings go with you.
And give you peace.
And give you peace.
Thank you. Thanks.
Todd and Heather, thank you. Once again, very engaging. And this was something meant to be very positive, that we could demonstrate that God does want us to have healthy relationships, healthy sexual lives. How do we deal with everything that is around us in the world and the witness that it can be? We're going to get to the panel discussion shortly, but we have about 12 minutes right now for any questions that you would like to ask of the Biermanns. Question over here? Okay. He's coming with the mic right now.
During the last administration, there was a real taking of gay marriage to other countries. And I was just wondering what you found in the countries that you've traveled to and their perceptions of marriage and gay marriage and what is right and wrong.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. In our travels in throughout Central and South America, the issue of homosexual relationships is growing, but what we found in Central and South America was it's growing in America. We need to grow here in that same way. You guys are the trendsetters. And so it's like they're looking up to, it's cool in America, we want to do it more. When we were in Peru especially, the young men, Daniel, both of them, very perceptive young men, college students, very educated. One was a history professor, and he was telling us that in Peru, there's not been this homosexual marriage, and it's still not very strong because there's a lot of cultural push against it. But With the current presidency in the United States, it's becoming more and more popular here because everyone says we need to keep up with America. And so we should start to popularize this and make it legal now so that we can keep up with America. And I said, so what, do you think it's going to keep growing? Go, unfortunately, I think so. So it just shows that we do have a lot of influence by our American belief up here. And it is having an impact around that other parts of the world, sad to say.
That could also work, I'm just thinking, positively. If
exactly.
We could turn the marriage cycle around in how we view human sexuality and our roles,
yep.
And that could be a powerful influence
and
as
so,
well.
Yeah, to dovetail on what Dave was just saying, when we were down there and we presented God's way for marriage, the people were almost like, oh, we thought you Americans would come and tell us how to be more free and more open, and now you're telling us it's better this way. Wow, that's a really great thing to hear. And so they were hungry to hear the truth of God's word. They really were. And when we came in with it, coming from a culture where it's countercultural to say what we are saying, they thought this must really be the truth because you're willing to go against the norm in your own country. And so it gave it a lot of extra weight when we went down there.
Great. Other questions? I'm so surprised.
Two things. I'm curious if you guys agree with this perspective that I heard once on forgiveness in general. They said that if you don't forgive, you are disrespecting God because he forgives. And then the other thing is in terms of like roles within the marriage and submission, like a lot of people my age, you know, hate submission and like submission is a dirty word. Mm-hmm. And it's like, how do you portray submission in a good light?
Mm-hmm.
Talk on forgiveness.
Okay, well, on the forgiveness point, absolutely. The forgiveness is something that's not an option for us. As Christ has forgiven us, so you also are to forgive one another, he says. So it is not an option, and it is the key that sets people free, and it sets you free. Same thing with people who've hurt us. We forgive because we need to let it go so that we are not carrying that burden ourselves. And it's up to Jesus in the final end to do the judging. It's not our place. So we forgive, and we grant that gift of forgiveness. On the submission point, submission is a hard word because the world has turned it into a dirty word in so many ways. Instead of seeing it as a beautiful word that when you submit to Christ, you receive all his gifts. The gifts that come to us is, I liked when, from Oswald Beyer, he talked about that point, as I mentioned before, that it is a matter of being given to. That's what submission is about, receiving from Jesus all his abundant blessings. And when you submit to Jesus, you get all his gifts given to you. When a wife submits to her husband who's doing his job right, she gets all those blessings of Jesus through her husband. If the husband's not doing his job right, then she can bypass up to the thumb and say, you're not doing it right, I'm going to go to Jesus here, so I'm going to be going to church this Sunday, and I'd love to have you come if you'd like to, but I need to go to Jesus because I need his forgiveness, and if you're not going to be giving it to me, I got to go there. Husbands, you don't disrespect the husband, but if the husband's forcing you to go against the will of Christ, then in a respectful way you say, thank you for your opinion, but I need to go to Jesus because his truth is conflicting with your truth right now. And so that submission, that's where you can do it, because it's a submission insofar as that husband is doing his role of the head of the household in line with Christ. And that's key to it all right? That it is following the line of Christ. But even if a husband isn't doing his job, it doesn't give a wife the right to say, I'm not submitting to him because he's not a Christian, he's not doing it. Remember Paul said, even if they're an unbeliever, stay, because you don't know, your prayers may win him over, may bring him in. So in a respectful way, say, I still love and respect you as the head of this household, and I will still try to honor you and your wishes, but I still must go to Christ and receive his gifts of forgiveness and love. And so my submission is first to him, then to you. And that's respectful, that's honoring, and it may win him over.
And we have often found in our marriage that if we have a disagreement, it is not me just saying, fine, whatever you want. That's not what submission means. It means that we then talk together through things. I had such a vision for something, and Todd didn't agree with my initial vision, But as we talked through it, I started to see things in a different way. We talked about it, and then we became on the same page. I don't feel like in our marriage we have ever agreed to disagree. In the end, we are always on the same page. And I think that's what a strong marriage should exemplify to the world.
And we can do it when we both submit to Christ, right? Because he brings us together. So,
I kind of like James Dobson's definition of submission. And he said to the woman, it's knowing when to duck so that when God swings, he gets a full shot at your husband. So.
Could you hear it?